Clovis was left agape, and he would remain so for some time thereafter, leaning against the tree behind which he'd hidden, gazing at the tremendous trunk of the king oak, mesmerized by the memory of the moment. Indeed, he may well have stayed that way for the rest of his life, if a nimble little gnome no taller than his thighs and sporting a red toadstool cap hadn't tugged on Clovis's pants leg and, grinning like a psychotic ringmaster, warned,
"Be thee ware, weary wanderer, and touch not the bough of mistletoe."
Just before popping a mushroom into his mouth, touching the side of his nose and somersaulting away. 30. Prior to the invention of the lightning rod, church towers were struck by lightning with embarrassing frequency. As bell towers were frequently the tallest structures in the skyline, this should not be surprising to modern minds. To 18th century churchgoers, however, who took Jesus at his word when he remarked, "I beheld Lucifer as lightning fall from heaven," it implied that God the Omnipotent was unable to protect his own houses of worship from Lucifer's lightning. Such majestic impotence fueled rumors that the church was in fact worshiping a false god, a demiurge whose half-assed contrivances were supremely susceptible to the prankish electricity of the true God's divine lightning. As it turns out, popular opinion so embraced this Gnostic heresy that lightning strikes are today deemed acts of God in the legal sense. Tornadoes, too, are generally considered acts of God by insurers, necessitating the purchase of additional tornado insurance policies if one hopes to be financially protected from the wrath of God. Few outside of Kansas fret over tornadoes when purchasing insurance, and this was certainly the case in Normal, Illinois. Even State Mutual Insurance, one of the largest insurers in the nation and Dave's employer, did not have tornado insurance.